With me in the studio today, I've got Aamir Butt from Lancor Scientific. Aamir, nice to see you. Good morning.
Nice to see you too, Andy.
We caught up with you, of course, a couple of weeks back. All eyes on this pre-ICO which you've got planned for the near future. So an incredibly busy but exciting time for the
very
company.
Very exciting, yeah.
Tell us what you're up to at the moment, what the plans are.
Well, so as you know, we're going to do this webinar on the 3rd, next Tuesday, with Proactive Investors. We're really looking forward to that. We've been working very, very hard over the last 2 months to actually understand sort of hypothesizing about the way the business will build and the scalable model that we can go to market with. And anybody involved in building a business will know that takes quite a while to do. So I'm very proud of the team that in the last 2 months alone, with some extremely good feedback from some of our advisors, we've been able to what's called pivot and understand how we actually achieve the vision that we have, which is making cancer screening available for everyone everywhere.
And so
we're very excited about that.
And what's the objective behind the ICO?
So the objective behind the ICO is to, ICOs are a form of crowdfunding. So you do two things with an ICO. One is that you raise the capital to execute on a vision. The vision that we have is making cancer screening available for everyone everywhere. Whilst at the same time socializing the idea to a big, broader audience across the globe about the proposition that you're building to take to market. So that's the opportunity we're very excited about.
And you're looking to raise a particular amount of cash?
Yes, we are. We have what's called a soft cap and a hard cap. If we achieve the lower bound, we can achieve some things. And if we achieve the upper bound, we can achieve greater things. That's anything from a soft cap of $5 million, we're talking US dollars, up to $50 million.
And this tagline that you've got, making cancer screening available to anybody, anywhere, this is via the blockchain. Why do you need the blockchain to do this?
To answer that question, let me just step back a little bit. I think, you know, why cancer screening? I think if you know anything about cancer, you know that to catch cancer early is what you need to do to prevent death or spending large amounts of taxpayer money to do sort of therapies to do with cancer. So the idea is to catch cancer early. To do that, you need to run screening programs. And there are several cancers that respond really, really well to running screening programs. In the UK, we have an excellent cervical cancer screening program, which has over the years proven to be extremely successful in reducing the fatalities, improving the quality of life, you know, for sufferers of cervical cancer. And so we know they work. But across the world, some countries either don't have any or they have really well managed. But even then, there are anomalies. Even in countries where the cancer screening programs are really well managed, like the UK, things can go wrong. I mean, recently we've had the breast cancer, you know, where around about 250 women over the last 15 years, their quality of life has been affected. That's the results that are being announced by the researchers themselves. So there is still room for improvement. Now, if you and in the cervical cancer screening world in the UK, we did our own health economic analysis that if our technology was being used in the UK, given the effectiveness that we already have, over the lifetime of the cohort, i.e. somebody who starts at the age of 25 in cervical cancer screening, goes all the way through and stops the cervical cancer screening at the age of, I think, 60. Forgive me if I'm just a few years out on that one. If they're using our technology, we still save $170 million. We perform about 70,000 less colposcopies. And we have an increase in what's called the quality-adjusted life years of 200,000 years. And it's an internal study, but we use the data from the NHS and we did what's called Markov modeling, and we got some extremely good results. So the question, I'm sorry, I'm laboring the point, but the question as to why blockchain? Across the world, these cancer screening programs in some parts of the world are better than others, and some don't have any at all. And the reason they don't is because the accuracy of the tests that are available, the costs associated with the tests that you've got to perform, the logistics that you have to set up, the pathology laboratories that you need to set up for transportation of samples, and all of that kind of stuff is both costly and operationally intensive to set up, and some countries don't have the resources to bring them on. But they are looking to do cancer screening. Everybody knows and understands cancer screening. Early detection is important, particularly because in every part of the world, the problem of cancer is increasing. So that's one reason. Cost, accuracy, blah, blah, blah. The other reason you have... So one of the ways to mitigate the costs associated with running these programs is that you try and target those groups of people who are most at risk for a specific cancer. A very good and clear example of that, it's an obvious one, but it shows the point, is prostate cancer is for men and cervical cancer is with women, so you don't want to test the whole population for cervical cancer. But there are certain risk groups which are more prone to have certain types of cancer. So if you can isolate those, and if you can say these are the groups and target them and run screening programs, which a lot of the developed countries are doing already, and then if you can visualize this, you know, a scenario where not just locally and regionally and nationally, but internationally, you're able to, and supranational organizations like the World Health Organization had access to what are called cancer registries, you can have not just locally, but globally, very, very targeted programs that can be very, very effective. But it doesn't happen because all of the data that is gathered in is in silos. I think there's only 6 countries, for example, in Africa, which actually have a cancer registry. And so because of those two things, it's actually, we're achieving very good results globally, despite those two scenarios. So where blockchain comes in, one of the ways to handle the second element of fragmented data is because data is held by nations, the responsibility for that data sits with the nations and the taxpayer, you know, the health services. Although that's really, really important for that to happen, if the user owns the data, then it's the user's responsibility as to who they give that access to. And I'm giving you just one example of where if things were slightly different, then the impact would be actually quite enormous for that, you know, sort of combined data sets. But one of the reasons why it doesn't happen is because the patient doesn't own the data. So right. The healthcare is patient-centric, and if the data was patient-centric too, it lends itself well to a global thinking and organization. However, we've not been able to do that so far. Microsoft did an excellent, and Apple did an excellent program of allowing people to enter their, you know, sort of host their medical records. They had degrees of success. But one of the reasons why people weren't actually just, you know, flocking and putting their data in was because it was owned by a particular company, the data, you know, and held by a particular company. This is the beauty of a blockchain. And I'm sorry it's taken so long, but it is important to get the background. The beauty of the blockchain is that if anybody accesses that data, it's immutably recorded. In other words, somebody can't go and change the fact that somebody accessed it. And any data change that occurs, again, is recorded for everybody, you know, for you to see. Because of that very, very subtle difference of a permanent record of not just you know, where my record gets amended, but also who gets to see it, is strong enough to be able to have a system where the patient is the center of the data as well as the healthcare. So when you get that kind of architecture delivering a screening program, plus a technology like Tumour Trace, which is in one device, you have multi-cancer diagnostic capability, at the point of test, so it doesn't have to go to a laboratory, at a cost which is orders of magnitude lower than potential alternatives. Both those two things combined give you the compelling argument for Lancor.
that's the beauty of the blockchain there. What's the beauty of doing an ICO? Why not raise cash through, say, the more traditional avenues?
So traditionally, when you are raising capital, and you know, for very good reasons, you know, you do a seed round, you do a small A and a little bigger A and a B and a C perhaps, and then you list on the IPO. It means that you are incrementally, and again from an investment point of view, correctly, incrementally achieving certain milestones and getting more and more money. What is extremely difficult, unless you know the money, is to be able to execute on a really big, bold vision. And of course, the other thing is, because you're taking investors who are high net worth individuals or VCs or institutions, you're not actually marketing what you're doing to the potential target audience, crowd sales, for example, as I mentioned earlier. So for those two reasons, when there is a new opportunity like raising capital through an initial coin offering, once you are able to demonstrate that you're not just a scam, that you've got a genuine proposition which is meeting a genuine unmet pent-up demand globally, then you become a very compelling proposition for an ICO to execute on bigger visions.
And your coin will be Medici?
Medici token, yeah, that's right.
And already you're seeing quite a bit of interest from potential investors?
Yeah, we had, we've had only two conversations with two different groups, and both of those groups, they've committed to come in with capital, which is blowing our soft cap out of the water. So we're really, really excited.
Very good. Well, exciting times ahead. Aamir, great to see you. Thank you.
Thank you.